Okay, so now let's see how that looks if we have, say, a conducting wire running through an existing magnetic field. So let's have a magnetic field which is running into the page, straight down into the page. We've got like a pile of refrigerator magnets or something like that going on, but for whatever reason, there's a magnetic field which is running down into the page. And we're gonna have a wire running through here, and we'll say that the conventional current is running that direction through the wire. So it's moving upward as we look at it here. So what we have to do now is use our right-hand rule for field and figure out what the magnetic field is around this conducting wire. So the current's running that direction, so I'm going to point my thumb in the direction of the conventional current, and I see that the magnetic field from that current is coming up out of the page on the left side of the wire. That's what my fingers are doing here. So that means that I have a field coming up. Dots, it's the arrow pointing toward us on the left side, and then on the right side of the wire, my fingers are curling downward, so that means that the magnetic field from the current in the wire is down into the page. I'll do that in purples to distinguish it from the original ones there. I don't know if the purples show up on your screen or not, but it is what it is. Okay, so now we're going to look at this and figure out what direction is the wire pushed. So on this side, on the right side, we have a magnetic field going down into the page from the environmental field, the ambient field, and a field going down into the page from the wire itself. And that's the situation where you have two fields which are running parallel and in the same direction. And that's repulsion. So that means that on this side, the force on the wire is going to be that direction. Okay? It's going to be pushing it to the left. Now, what about over here? On the left side, we have a magnetic field coming up out of the page from the current through the wire and moving down into the page from that ambient field. So this is the situation over here where we have two fields which are running in opposite directions, and that's an attraction. So again, on this side, it's going to make a force on the wire in this direction. Okay, so in both cases, it's pushing the wire to the left, and net the force on the wire is going to be to the left, with conventional current moving this direction. Now, the source of possible confusion on this is, you gotta remember, conventional current means that positive charges are moving that way, even though in reality this means that electrons, negative charges, are actually moving downward. So, read carefully if they're talking about electrons throwing through the wire or conventional current flowing through the wire. They shouldn't be that mean to you, but you never know. This, by the way, is on page 784 in your book, is where they talk about this stuff. Now, what if in what if we change it a little bit? What if we say that the magnetic field is running in the plane of the page, like this? Okay? And then we run our current-carrying wire kind of the same way we did before. We'll have the current going up this way. Now, in this case, hopefully you can see, there's going to be less force because the direction of the moving charges is not exactly perpendicular to the magnetic field. In this situation over here, the charges were exactly perpendicular to the magnetic field, so we had maximum force going sideways. But here they're aligned a little bit. And let's imagine this just for a moment. What if the wire, instead of going this direction, was going this way, and it was actually parallel to the magnetic field? And as you remember from the last equation, I guess that was 24.5, the QV sine theta B. If the charges are moving in the same direction as the magnetic field, then they exert no force because this the uh, your forefinger and your thumb, the direction of the field and the direction of the velocity are the same. There's no angle. Sine of zero degrees is zero, so there will be no force. So with the wire going at an angle like this, we have to take the sine of this angle into account to figure out the magnitude of the force. So this is one where AP sometimes will have you pay attention to the angle, but we should get to the equation for the force on a wire right now. So I'll do this. This is equation 24.9. And is on page 784 in your textbook. Okay, and this is for the force on a wire. Force on a wire. That's conducting. That's carrying current. If there's no current flowing through it, there is going to be no force on the wire, so it has to be carrying current. I should make that clear. Anyway, the equation is F on a wire, this is in the book, is equal to I L B, beta really, sine alpha. Okay. AP, this is the book, AP says it's the magnetic force, and they do it in terms of I L sine theta beta. And they put some absolute values around these things as well, but I'm going to not clutter it up too badly. Now, what does all this mean? Okay, this is again, this is the force in newtons. Force in newtons. I is just what it's always been. It is the current in amps. Okay? Or amps. L, the cursive L for AP and the capital L in the book, is the length of the wire, that's in the magnetic field. That's in the field. Okay? And for our problems, we always assume that the magnetic field is the same everywhere. So if we have a problem like this, we will say that through this entire region here, that the magnetic fields is always the same. You know, so it'd be like 6 Teslas or something like that. But it's going to be the same value everywhere, so you don't have to worry about it's weaker over here and stronger in the middle and try to figure out a function to describe how it changes. Again, calculus makes that a lot easier, and we don't do calculus, so there we are again. Anyway, length of the wire that's in the field, and that is going to be in meters. Theta is the angle between the wires and the current. I'm sorry, the angle between the magnetic field and the current. Angle between the mag field and the current. And that's going to be in degrees. And then finally, beta is the magnetic field in Teslas. So let's run through one problem here. I have some power lines that run by my house, and during this time off, I've been going for walks both days. So I walk underneath the power lines because there's a trail there. So let's imagine here that the power lines are 100 meters apart. Okay, 100 meters apart, and we'll say they have 850 amps running through them. Now we know it's actually AC current, so it'd be kind of different, but let's just pretend for a moment that it's DC current. But 850 amps running through them. And let's see, Earth's magnetic field is accepted as 5 times 10 to the minus 5th Teslas. And we're roughly 45 degrees north here, so let's say that the magnetic field runs 45 degrees away from horizontal. So the magnetic field is actually coming into the Earth where we are, and we'll call it 45 degrees away from the vertical. And we want to figure out, in a 100 meter section of this high tension line between two of the big posts, how much force is exerted on that wire by Earth's magnetic field. That's our question here. Okay, so we're going to use this equation, the AP version. The magnetic force is IL sine theta B. And we'll get, so the magnetic force is equal to the current, that's I, so that's 850 amps, times the length of wire that we're interested in, which is 100 meters, times the sine of the angle between the magnetic field and the direction of the current in the wire, which is the sine of 45 degrees, which comes out to be 0.707. Pretty sure I'm right on that one. And then the strength of the magnetic field is 5 times 10 to the minus 5th Teslas. That's how you lay it out. It's basically just a plug and play. You run it through and let's see. I get almost exactly three newtons. Isn't that nice? Okay, so almost exactly three newtons. So three newtons in 100 meters of wire, that's not a whole lot. But let's see, if we had a very, very thin wire, like we'd use for winding a little motor in a model airplane or something like that, a very, very fine wire, you might be able to get... 300 grams. 300 grams of wire to go 100 meters. You could probably do that. So a very fine wire might do it, like for winding a guitar coil or something like that. You might be able to get 300 grams. If you ran 850 amps through a wire that fine, probably wouldn't last very long, would probably smoke itself almost instantly. But if you did have a long wire like that, it was like struck with a bolt of lightning where you had a very large current going through it, even for a very short period of time, it would visibly and noticeably throw that wire before it vaporized. It wouldn't just stay in one place and then start glowing like a light bulb filament. It would get thrown around pretty severely by a heavy current like that. So, yeah, okay, 3 newtons on a 100-meter line, but hey, at least we can figure these things out.